Hello everybody and welcome to the MLittleProgramming tutorial. Please drop a like on the video as it really helps the channel and subscribe if you haven't already. Let's get into it. In today's video, we're going to be looking at for loops, what for loops are, how to use them, and when to use them. So what is a for loop? A for loop is used to iterate over a sequence. A sequence can be a list, a tuple, a dictionary, a set, or a string. With the for loop, we can execute a set of statements, once for each item in the sequence. A for loop can also be used to do a specific task a set number of times. So let's say we have a print statement, print MLittleProgramming. We know that we can print that once, but how would you print this 10 times? Maybe you would type this line out 10 times, but this method does not scale. So what about printing this 100 or 1000 times? You can't just keep typing the print statement over and over, it would take too long. But what you can do is use a for loop. We can place this print statement inside of our for loop, and get the for loop to execute this print statement a certain number of times. So the syntax for a for loop is to use the for keyword followed by a space. Next, we define a variable. This variable can represent the current item we are on whilst iterating through the list. This variable can also represent a counter. The syntax for both these options is the same. It's merely how you think about the functionality that you're trying to produce from the for loop. In the example of the print statement, we are going to call our variable I. Calling a counter I is commonplace within Python and the software development community more generally. The next piece of syntax is the word which links to our last piece of syntax, which is to tell Python the number of times we want to execute the sequence events within the for loop. This is the word in. There are a number of ways we can indicate to Python how many times we want to iterate over the block of code within the for loop. For this first example, we're going to use the range piece of syntax. The range function returns a sequence of numbers, starting from 0 and incrementing by 1 by default, and ends at a specified number. There are a number of variations of this function to change the defaults, and we'll look into those throughout the video. For now, we just want to print this print statement 10 times. So to do that, we pass 10 into the range function. After this, like in the if statement syntax we looked into in the last video, we end our for loop declaration with a colon. Following this, we indent the code we want to be executed every time the for loop is run. So we're going to type print MLittleProgramming. And if we run that, we can see that MLittleProgramming is printed 10 times. Let's say now that we want to print the numbers 1 to 10. So if we just replace the string MLittleProgramming with the variable I, the counter we've defined here. When we run this, we see that this prints 0 to 9, as that's the default for the range function that we've defined. What we can do to print 1 to 10 is to change the arguments that we passed into the range function here. For this, we're going to need two arguments. So when we have two arguments, the first argument is the start of the counter, and the second argument is the end of the counter plus 1. So to print the numbers 1 to 10, the two arguments we pass in are going to be 1 and 11. So let's print that now. And as you can see, this outputs 1 to 10. Now let's think about a different example. What if we wanted to print the 2 times table? So far we've been incrementing the sequence by 1, as that's the default for the range function. But in this case, we want to increment by 2. The range function actually has a third parameter in which we can change the amount we're incrementing by. So for the 2 times table, we'd want to start the sequence with 2 and end the sequence with, say, 20, 10 times 2. So we'd pass in 21 as the second parameter, and then the third parameter is how much we're going to increment by, so 2. As we run that, you see that we have printed 2 to 20 in increments of 2. We've now looked at both integers and strings, but for loops can also be used to iterate through lists. So let's define a list above our for loop. Let's use the list we used in the list video, so we use a list of groceries, apples, bananas, and grapes. If you haven't seen that video, there'll be a link in the top right now, and in the description down below. Following this, this is where we can use this variable here to describe the individual item in the list. So we can call it individual grocery, an item. We also need to change this range piece of syntax we've been using to the name of our list, so groceries. Inside this for loop, we can just print item, and this will print every item in the list. As you can see, when we run this, it prints every item in the list. But these for loops so far we've been looking at have been simple, and we've been happy to let them run until completion. However, there are use cases where we want to stop the loop before we iterate right to the finish we've initially declared. Let's add a few more items to this grocery list to make this benefit the syntax we're about to see a little bit more obvious. Okay, so I've added a few items to our list, and so now we have 10 items in our list. Let's say we want to check that we have bananas in this list. What we can do is place an if statement inside of this for loop. The if statement is going to do a string comparison between the current item and the string bananas. Inside this if statement, we're going to use the break syntax. What this break statement does is stop the loop, and then Python will continue to read the code in the sequence it was before the loop. We can show this by adding some print statements. We'll add one before we go into the loop, one as we enter the for loop, and one as we enter the if statement, and then one just after we finish the loop. So now we run that, let's just explain what happened, because there's a lot going on. So we enter the for loop once, we don't meet the criteria for the if statement, so we enter the loop again. This time, the second item in the list is bananas, so we meet the criteria for the if statement, and so we just enter the if statement, and that means we reach the break statement. This means that the loop stops, and then we continue with the code sequence, therefore it prints the outside if statement. Another piece of syntax that impacts the iterations of the loop is the continue statement. With the continue statement, we can stop the current iteration of the loop and continue with the next. So where is this useful? Well, let's take the example that we have with the break statement. We'll replace the break statement with the continue statement. This time we're also going to print the item after the if statement. Let's just run this and we'll go through what happens. So we enter the for loop, we don't satisfy the if statement, and so we print the first item, apple. We then enter the for loop for a second time. This time we do satisfy the if statement. What happens now is the continue statement means that we stop this iteration of the for loop, meaning we skip this print statement, and we go back to the start of the for loop for the next iteration. The for loop then continues, unaffected from here on out. When we're using for loops, we may also want to do something when the loop is finished. There is a piece of syntax for this, and that is using else. So for this example, we're just going to remove a few of the print statements to clear up the code. In fact, we're going to remove every bit of code inside of the loop, apart from printing the current item we're iterating over. The else is going to be on the same indentation level as where the for loop is being defined. Inside this else statement, we're going to print finish loop. As we run that, you'll see that every item in the list has been printed, and at the end, we've got our finish loop statement printed out. So far we've looked at both single layer for loops and lists. However, as we know from the list video, we can also have lists of lists. We can use these for loops to iterate through these types of lists as well, using a nested for loop. A nested for loop is a for loop inside another for loop. So we're just going to type out the skeleton structure of the nested for loop. We're going to put print statements inside both the outer for loop and the inner for loop to show how this works. For the moment, we're going to go back to using the range syntax. We're going to run the outside for loop 3 times and the inside for loop 3 times. So as we run through this, we can see what is happening. We enter the outer for loop, then we enter the inner for loop and iterate through it 3 times. We then leave the inner for loop and go back to the top of the outer for loop, printing outer loop. Then we go back to the inner for loop, printing inner loop 3 times. Then we do the same for the final iteration of the outer loop before exiting the for loop altogether. So now let's create a list of lists above our for loop and remove the 2 print statements inside of the nested for loops. On the outer for loop, we're going to iterate through individual lists inside list of lists. On the inner loop, we're going to iterate through the individual items in that list. Inside the inner for loop, we're then going to print that item. As you can see, when we run that, we're printing each individual item in the lists, which just about wraps up today's video. Thank you for watching this video. I hope you got a lot of value from it. If you would like more Python programming tutorials, there is a link in the top right now, and a link in the description down below, to a playlist of Python programming tutorials. With that said, if you enjoyed the video, please drop a like, as it really helps the channel, and subscribe if you haven't already. Also, if you've got any questions, drop a comment down below, and I'll get back to you.